What do you see when you leave your home in the morning? Do you see trees? Do you see a shopping mall, a restaurant, a cafe? Or do you see cars? What do you hear when you leave your home? Do you hear birds, shouting, screaming? Or do you hear traffic and honking? What do you want to see when you leave your home, when you leave your front door in the morning? What do you want to hear? And this is where my story begins. It began 2 years ago, directly in my neighborhood. And my neighborhood, that means this is the area where my kids are playing with their friends, where they go to school, where they cycle to school sometimes, where I do my daily errands. This is my surrounding. 2 years ago, a sports utility vehicle crashed into a group of people and killed four of them. You know sports utility vehicle, SUVs, a huge car. Well, everything gets smaller and tinier and smarter, cars get bigger and bigger and bigger. Among these four people, there was a small child and his grandmother. They died while walking on the pavement, while walking in a public space. Do you know what public space is? Public space is parks. Public space is greenery. Of course, we all know this. It's a pedestrianized area. Yes, for sure. But public spaces are roads, infrastructure as well. In Europe, I would say roads and infrastructure have been established at least 60, 70 years ago, after the Second World War. They haven't changed at all. We as a society, we changed tremendously since then. We changed our consumption patterns, our mobility patterns, our lifestyles, our aspirations. Everything changed. But our streets over there, they haven't changed. Our streets are historic present. They are history in the present. And we are the present future. From here we go, and from here we design our future. So let's start with ourselves. Today, roughly 4.5 billion people are living in cities, 60% of world population. And this figure will sum up to more than 60-70% in 2050. So more than 6 billion people will live in cities. And that is great news, because we need people in cities. We need the urban density, the proximity, the ideas to fight climate change and to fight all the problems that are soon to come. In contrast, today, 9 million people are dying in cities. We are dying in cities, literally every minute, because of poor air quality. About 30% in Europe can be accounted for road transport for carbon dioxide emissions, CO2 emissions. And while other sectors are continuously decreasing their emissions since 1990, the road transport sector is continuously growing due to our spaces, due to our environment. We get what we design. We get what we design. every day. Though I think what we need is a spatial transformation, a spatial turnaround. In German, I would say a Raumwende. And a Raumwende consists of five issues that I would like briefly to talk about. I would like to talk about integrative spaces. Integrative spaces are not exclusive. Today, streets and roads define barriers. They define neighborhoods. They define where our kids are playing. We are telling our children, don't cross the street. It's dangerous. So we need spaces that integrate people, that integrate ideas, that invite for communication, for encounters, for innovation. We need inclusive spaces. That means spaces for all social groups, gender, age, ethnics. I would like to give you an example. In Germany, 1/3 of all women feel not safe when being in public. They feel not safe when using public transport. And this figure goes up to more than 60% in South America. Our spaces are not inclusive at all. And safety is a huge part of this. Did you know that clearing snow has a huge gender effect? In Karlskoga, this is a small town in Sweden, they discussed the gender issue in urban planning and transport planning. And they asked themselves, what does clearing of snow has to do with gender? They made a study, and they identified men are more likely to use a car on the street, while women are more likely to use the pavement or cycling. So what does it mean? When there's snow, you know, these little white flakes, and you are walking on a pavement, it's pretty hard to push your bicycle, to push a buggy, or even use a wheelchair. But it's very easy to drive with your car. And instead, they recognized that a lot of women during the winter had to go to the doctor or were even in the hospital because of broken legs, broken wrists, just injured due to slippery ice and snow conditions. So they turned they switched the order of how to clear snow in the city. First, it was clearing the streets at first and then the pavement, and now they switched the order. Clearing the pavement first and then the street. No doctors, no hospitals has been visited by women anymore, at no extra cost. So now in Sweden, in the whole country, clearing snow is made by pavement first and street second. Multifunctional spaces. Today, our environments are pretty much functional, distinct in their definition. We have these residential areas on its own, especially in the suburbs. We have very much business areas. We have residential areas maybe all over the place. So this causes traffic. This causes the notion of where do I have to go to visit the next urban function. So what we need is on every square meter, we need the idea of bringing every function to one place, to one house, to my neighborhood. And this will overcome traffic. And this will make cities safer and more vivid. And finally, sustainable places. We will soon experience temperatures of more than 40 degrees in the summer. We need trees. We need open surfaces to live under these conditions. In Brussels, they found in a suburb this very typical marketplace, the square. It was used for parking. 100 cars have been parked here. And they decided to redesign. They decided to take all the cars away and make a place for communication, a place where kids are playing. And everyone benefited from it. The neighborhood, the city, and even retail. It's a completely new city now. In Sweden, they introduced the notion of the one-minute city. One-minute city means, what do you need in the first, let's say, 15 meters, 25 meters around your front door? Do you need a bench? Do you need a scooter rack? Do you need a playground? And they are just building it. They are building it for the people who live there. And they are building it directly on the street for using urban furniture, parklets. In Copenhagen, we have Nordhorn, a completely new district. Or we have other districts all over Europe, not in Germany. In Aspern, for example, in Vienna, there's a district that is being designed by women for women, designed through the eyes of children. You have public space in these neighborhoods that are devoted 80% only for walking, only for cycling, and no cars. In Germany, currently it is 50% of public space is being devoted for cars, either moving or parked. In Paris, there's a mayor, Anne Hidalgo, a woman. She introduced the idea of the 15-minute city. So not meters anymore, but minutes. That means decentralization of all urban functions everywhere in the city, especially in the suburbs, where we used to have very distinct, very defined functional neighborhoods. This is an old barrack, military use, very monofunctional. Today, it's a public area with trees, it's a library, it's a kindergarten, it's a residential area, it's a nursery, there's a doctor as well, shopping. You find everything. You can visit other parts in the city, that's for sure, but you don't have to. And that makes a difference. In Milan, 3 million additional trees will be planted in future. Why are they doing so? To reduce the temperature of the day by 2 degrees Celsius. In Shonan, China, they built a self-sufficient city, a post-corona city. That means you have urban gardening everywhere. And you have no streets like our traditional street design anymore. It's only walking, cycling, and autonomous shared vehicles for waste removal, for delivering packages, or whatsoever. It's a new city. It's a new idea. When you return today, ask yourself, ask your partner, what do you want to see? What do you want to hear in front of your door? What do you need? What do your kids need? Do they have any wishes? What do these images do to you? Do you feel how your inner space expanded in reaction to these positive images? I can feel it. And that's very typical. because we tend to react positively when we see spaces that are designed for human needs. So let's do it all together. Let's change our neighborhood. Let's change the space directly in front of our door. And let's do it now. Thank you.